Ole, 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 ole. Feeling hot, hot, hot. Feeling hot, hot, hot. Feeling hot, hot, hot. Feeling hot, hot, hot.
Collaboration between the Montserrat Tourism Division and the Antigua Broadcasting Service Station, a familiarization trip was planned and a team was dispatched to explore the Emerald Isle, yet another one of the Caribbean's hidden gems. Jaden's son. The mode of transportation which is easiest and most affordable to travel to the island is not only spacious and luxurious, but safe and effective, fully air-conditioned with cushioned seating and complimentary Wi-Fi services.
If none of y'all ever been to Montserrat and you keep saying, oh, water, well, look at this. This is like a 747 airline, okay?
Look at luxury.
Taking you through the board. You can see what's up, and it's so comfortable. Let me see.
Comfortable.
You understand what I'm saying? This is what we're dealing with right now.
The garbage bins inside.
$150 go, $150 come, $300, you're good to go. Montserrat, trust me. Ooh, awesome, bye. Awesome.
When we're so long, now ship back home, wailing down the town. I wanna run, I wanna jump, I wanna.
I mean, ladies and gentlemen, you don't usually get this view whenever you're coming on the ferry because you're always inside relaxing and everything.
In the AC.
But this is what it is. If you look over there, that's Fort James. Historical Fort James. That's where it is.
St. John's.
Quarter Harbor that they're working on with the project. And St. John City! Mount St. John Medical Center, that's right here. And this is an exclusive view. An all-inclusive
view. All-inclusive view?
Exclusive. Trust me, exclusive. But see one of our tugboats there?
Now, while most persons are anxious about commuting via boat, the most alarming point would be an hour into the trip over, when the boat encounters rougher waters and what is referred to as the yellow hole. For an approximate 30-minute period, the waters are rough, but manageable for the average passenger. Deep breaths, some water, and motion sickness tablets are encouraged prior to departure.
All months treasures abroad, leave!
Montserrat is famous for its peace and its tranquil environment, an island that promotes rest and relaxation. Just ask Adele Lake, a frequent visitor to the island.
Nobody go run me, away from me country, hear me go stay till kingdom come.
Why do I keep coming back to Montserrat? I suppose you can say, having lived in the United States for so many years and worked on Wall Street, the stress of the job. For me, coming back to Montserrat gave me some balance. It centers me. And I come back just for the peace and quiet. The minute I hit the island, the smell, the aroma, I mean the pleasant smell of the island, the cedar, the mahogany, there's a certain smell that comes back to me from childhood.
Montserrat is an island in the Leeward Islands, which is a part of the chain known as the Lesser Antilles in the West Indies. Prior to volcanic activity, Montserrat measured some 39 square miles. With the extreme activity and movement, the island is still expanding, and cartographers are yet to determine the new measurement. Welcome to Montserrat, popularly referred to as the Emerald Isle of the Caribbean.
Hi, morning. Thank you.
So,
I like my bag, it's nice and small.
Whatever. Right now, we're going to show you how it is and the things
Adam,
you got to do.
Careful, please.
And I just don't want my camera guy fall off the dock.
Please don't fall off the dock.
So,
Don't worry, it's the drone.
Oh yeah, the shrimp and the Barbie. Oh no, this is not Australia, it's Montserrat. Oh, so I guess them some of the restaurants and so forth.
Yeah. Summer breeze.
Oh, we're coming here to eat. I saw that on the itinerary.
You're having
today? Or tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Okay. So we're off to Alveston House now. This is Marine Village, everybody. We are here. This is Montserrat. Ooh. Montserrat. Montserrat, however you call it, the same place. Okay?
En route to our residence for this day, we pit stopped at Hilltop, home to all archived history, pictures, albums, and the legendary Arrow Wall.
This is Montserrat culture. We'll be proud of it forever.
It's been 8 years since there's been any activity whatsoever.
8 years.
Yeah. The volcano
there isn't even, yeah, there's no seismic. It's very, very, very quiet. So it's been quite a while. But it was 15 years that it was busy. Mm-hmm. This volcano wall here, this is from the space shuttle. This is 217 miles out in space.
Wow.
Going around the Earth. And they have very good lenses, as you can see.
Mm-hmm.
Here's a picture of the space shuttle as it passed in front of the moon. That's how small it is. Up here is a minute and a half time exposure. So that didn't happen all at once. It happened over a minute and a half with the lens open in 1997, when it was very active.
Oh, we're going to get a chance to go over this side later on today. So
some of the things we can't see, so it's good for us to actually get the visuals.
That's what we have up here at Hilltop Coffee House. It's probably the best kept secret in Montserrat.
All right.
It's a museum and a gallery in history. This is a town before it was buried. The land comes out to here now. So if you go in, you'll only go to the end of the pier.
Oh.
These are progressive burial of town. You can see the clock was 20 feet over Parliament Street. A few years ago it was here. The Methodist Church and the rest is all buried now. These are a library of all books written about Montserrat's eruption. There's a number of different books. I published this one 2 years ago because people wanted to hear the story of videoing the volcano with 160 photographs.
Oh, wow.
Going back to when we came.
But how difficult was it for you to preserve that, I mean, through the destruction, through the damage, through everything?
Yeah, I mean, the video documentary, The Price of Paradise, there is a price you pay to live in paradise.
Okay, right.
As you guys know.
Yeah, yes, we know this. Yes. So how long have you been on island?
We've been here 38 years.
So 38 years.
Yeah, we went through the whole thing.
The whole thing.
The 6.5 earthquake and Hurricane Hugo and the rest. This is a memorial to Aro. Most of you would know who's Aro.
Yes.
But
yes.
A lot of people don't know he did 33 albums. But one song, Hot, 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 took him all over the world.
That's it.
I was digitizing all his old VHS footage when he got the brain tumor 8 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And was quite surprised to see that whether he was in Tokyo, Paris, Rio, Hamburg, Germany, everybody knew the words to the song.
Okay.
Pretty incredible. He passed away 7 years ago. It's hard to believe. This was a tribute. Now it's a memorial to Sir George Martin, the producer of the Beatles. This is a picture of George 2 years before he left. He's since passed away.
So he was living here?
He lived here. He had a house here. But Air Studios is a big piece of the Montserrat history. George produced the Beatles. He did all the work with the Beatles at Abbey Road Studio. Paul McCartney said in his eulogy that without George, the Beatles would have never been who they were because it was his classical influence and his production that really put him on the map.
On the drive past the government offices, the public market, and through the town, we were introduced to the natural springs of Montserrat, where we could stop at the side of the road and grab a drink of fresh local water, au naturel.
So we cannot come to this island without drinking from the fountain that God created.
And it says if you drink from this, you're bound to return
to Montserrat.
To Montserrat. I don't think any of us have a problem with that though. Ready?
Ready for what? Go in with your hand, man. Yeah. You know, let me get some of that. Here. Let me get some of that. Eruption.
Really, Stevie?
fountain that God built. Okay, the bump just got out my face. It's working. It is working.
Arriving at our home for the duration of our stay, we were surprised at the beautiful scenery, comfortably resting on 5 acres of land. The history behind our accommodation was most beautiful, interesting, and exhilarating.
Hi, good afternoon.
Nice to meet you.
I'm Steve.
Hi, yes, nice to meet you. Sarah.
Hi, Sarah.
Sarah Patrice. Hi. Nice to meet you.
Thanks for having
and
us.
And this is Cherise.
Yes, I'm Cherise.
So it's Alveston House. Why is it Alveston House and it's a
give
house?
Give us a little history. Okay, it was a plantation house back in the day. So this was one of the master's house. So it was our estate. Mm. It's currently on 5 acres.
Wow.
So we have a tennis court, a pool, and some plantation grounds at the back.
Okay.
Can we play tennis?
Yeah.
Can we go in the pool?
Of course.
All right.
Of course. And then Sir George Martin, it used to be wooden, and Sir George Martin bought it, and the person that bought the wooden structure was Carol Osborne's grandfather, Cedric Osborne's grandfather bought the wooden structure, and then they made it concrete.
But I'm seeing it saying restaurant and bars. It's still like a home.
Yeah, it's still a home.
So it's like a family feeling.
It is a family feeling. In January, when Lady Martin comes down for her visit, we close down, we put all the tables and chairs away, and we make it a home.
Oh!
So we are her personal chefs and servers at that time.
What's that?
That's a 12 o'clock alarm.
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Okay.
Like our own personal big men.
Okay.
All right. And I think they knew that I was coming. My favorite color is purple. So they decked me out in full purple. Got coffee, tea, nice fridge, closet big enough, pato. I'm comfortable with home. Okay.
So we just met our driver slash tour guide slash
Ibis's, his name is Norman.
Ibis's new BFF in Montserrat. We're going, he's taking us all over the place. But I think the most important thing for us would be to show you the volcano. I think everybody, well, when you hear Montserrat,
when you hear
you automatically
listen,
think
listen,
volcano.
Listen, not volcano in volcano. We're going to the ravished side. Use the nice word.
The what?
The ravished side.
The what?
Okay, the side that tourists can go now.
Okay, okay, okay. Now we are coming.
Yeah.
So we're going to the side, and it hasn't been active for 8 years.
Eight
am I
years.
Correct?
Eight years. No, active for eight.
No visual manifestation of activity.
Okay, the big words.
Yeah,
no visual manifestation.
In our work. Yes.
So we're going to show you that, because everybody, we want to dispel the fear and the myth that you can't come to Montserrat. There's no life happening.
But the funny thing is, no. That this spell is just showing you that you can go on tour there too.
It's the same thing.
No,
rid of the fear and the myth that you can't come here and you can't experience life and vacation.
Norman.
In Montserrat.
Yes, sir.
So please,
meet
Norman.
In the area where my people live.
So Norman, say hi to the people of Antigua and Barbuda.
Hi, folks. But I just wanted to bring you in this area of Vista because many of you would have traveled on a very personal airline we call Liat, the Caribbean airline.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly where Liat started.
Really?
Understood.
Exactly. Now listen, this was...
Now what is the population like currently in Montserrat?
Okay, let me just back up a bit. Initially pre-volcano, the population was 10,000 plus.
Okay.
And at one point it went down to 2,500. And now it's back around 5,000.
Okay.
However, the demographic is a bit different in the sense that about half of the population is made up of other CARICOM nationals in terms of Jamaicans, Guyanese, Santo Domingans, all who have come to help us in terms of the rebuilding process.
Okay.
So we do appreciate that. And we also have an initiative to try to build a population. So if any of you guys want to stay on.
I think I know who does.
As you look towards the north of the island,
mm-hmm.
You can see in the extreme north, that's the Silver Hill Range. But at the left-hand side, the northwestern tip, you can see there's some jagged mountain ranges with some lightened inner sides.
Yes.
That's an old crater in the Silver Hills area. If you took a hike, you can actually go there and you can find sulfur crystals. And, you know, it's a very interesting hiking trail that leads over to that end, which is the Silver Hill Range. This facility actually was used at one point during the relocations to house the Montserrat Volcano Observatory first, as well as the NS Osborne's, because this is a family-owned business of the Osborne family. And they moved their supermarket, their hardware store, everything into this location. So you can imagine some of the issues in terms of what I was telling you about businesses having to relocate.
It is also important to note that with heavy rainfall, the landmass in Montserrat continues to expand, still leaving its measurement a mystery.
Right here, I have what was a brochure of the Viewpoint Hotel. And this shows you how beautiful it was. There's a little bit of the golf course in the background.
That's over there.
Yeah. But I'm going to just take you down on the beach line below, the Old Road Beach, for you to understand why we say Montserrat is still growing. Well, right here on the left, you'll see the remnants of what was the tennis courts.
So all that is ash still?
Yeah, that's ash pile there. You can see some of the lights that were there.
Yeah.
And there's some brief, minimal remains of what was the beach bar. There was a wooden beach bar here. I want you to really take notice here now, because as we go across here, this is the cliff line. And then the sea was right here.
The sea was right here?
The sea was right lapping onto the coast right there. This, what we're driving on, was the jetty that you're seeing in the photograph here. So you can see from the photograph, this is the jetty. This is what we're driving on. And you had the sea in between here. So
let me pass here.
All this has been filled in by material coming down.
And all this is ash and new land.
All this is material that has been brought down by rainfall off the slopes of the dome back there.
So this is basically a new piece of land.
So when you refer to growth now, you're speaking to
just these areas.
Okay.
As we go along, you'll see several areas where there are new pieces of land growing and defining, making new definitions in terms of the coastline of Montserrat. You'll see how far this is. Well over 300 yards in terms of the distance. But interestingly, like, as you go off the coast, it's like a sheer drop. You know, when you go out like about 20 feet, 20, 30 feet, it drops off to like 60 feet deep.
It's
just like a shelf that is just hanging there. Because this is material brought down, and you know,
as it
gets into the coastal side,
how far
the deposit stays there.
How far would the coast be?
It's just right there, the new land. So if you look backwards, where that tree line was, that was basically like where the original beach line was.
What?
Curving. Like, as you see from the photograph, it went inland, curved.
So and then you had a new piece.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm still seeing them houses up there like normal, like nothing never happened to them or anything like that. Is it because of over the years?
Well, a lot of them have been actually renovated. The ash fall and the fallout from the volcanic activity, which at times could have been light acid rain. There were times when because I live just in Alveston.
Acid rain.
Yeah, when we hung out our laundry, we came back and found some little round holes in it. Wow. And that was as a result of acid rain. Yeah, but you see, one of the things about Montserrat, which a lot of people like as visitors, is the peace and tranquility.
Yes.
You'd find, like most of us, I just left my vehicle over in St. Peter's that I was driving before this, and the key is in ignition. And you know, that's what we do with our homes sometimes. We don't have a key for the house. Where I grew up, we never had any keys. The house was never locked. You know, that's the other day where I'm living in Alveston, we were painting our front door. So we just took it off for 2 weeks. We just took the door off. Yeah.
And just walk out.
Yeah, it's no problem.
But one thing I love about the people though, I can tell, it's like a family oriented island. Everybody know everybody. Everybody is everybody. You want a drink?
What's Montserrat size?
Well, it was 39.6. We've grown at least another 5 to 7 square miles as a result of
flood water and catch that side.
Now we're starting to drive on some of the material that came down the bellum. This material in some instances is about 40 feet deep.
40 feet?
40 feet.
That's sturdy.
There were two houses, there were two houses over yonder, and they have been completely covered.
They're buried right now?
Yeah. And there's another one on the edge, but I'll show you that a little later when we're coming back this week. So, but the thing is, with every adversity comes opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
This has now built a very vibrant sand mining multi-million dollar industry.
Okay.
We have about five private sand miners who, on almost like on a daily basis, this material is being exported to neighboring islands for various reasons, whether it be for in use in construction, doing golf courses. Even sometimes they use the rocks, different sizes, as you can see on the right here. And as we come up on the famous Cork Hill Junction, you see the remnants of what was, we used to call it Shovel's Bar.
Mm-hmm.
This was a bar that was always open. As a matter of fact, the villagers would tell you that this bar was so unique in the sense of the village that the folks who owned it would leave it open, and the villagers would go and take whatever drink they want and put their money in a basket.
Wow! You know, think we can do that?
Around the time when the population went down to 2,500,
mm-hmm.
the majority of the populace actually went to Antigua. At one point, you had well over 3,000 Montserratians who had migrated to Antigua. And that's why initially I was saying, you know, we really have to cherish the fact that Antiguans opened their doors to Montserrat. It was almost like hassle-free in the sense that people showed up, mm-hmm. and even for work, whereas other nationals had to have a work permit, Montserratians were allowed to start working without even a work permit. And, you know, that was really fantastic.
The former capital, Plymouth, is now a restricted area, and you can only gain access once you have police permission and police escort. What was most intriguing about Norman's tours were the before photographs he had laminated for preservation in comparison to where we stood. Barely any buildings in sight.
This is the Methodist Church here, Charles Mercer Supermarket. Then this is the Wall & Company building with the dormers. You're seeing it over there, the black roof.
I don't know where I'm gonna go when the ball came through. Yeah,
was what Montserrat was, but life quickly turned around. And now we move on to the positives, the exciting stuff. We met an interesting man of history. He studies the wildlife and the natural habitats in Montserrat. Scriber is his name, and what a hike it was.
Yes, good morning to everyone. Welcome to Montserrat, and welcome to Scriber's Adventure Tours. We're going to be doing this trail, which is called the Duberry Cassava Trail. This would be just over an hour, you know, it's a quite easy trail, I should say. And there's lots of different things that you can see on this trail as well, which you're coming out with Scriber this morning. This is an educational hike that you'll be on as well. It's a pleasure for me to have you guys here, you know, and any question that comes to mind, feel free and ask Scriber just about anything.
So James Scriber Daily.
Yes.
How'd you get the name Scriber?
Well, at school, I used to like to do a lot of writing, you know, and you know, they always say I was good at scribing, but also my teachers used to say I was very good at describing things, you know, and so, you know, they used to take me in front of the class, and once I get it, they would say, okay, James Daly, because that's my correct name, James Daly, you come out and describe it to the rest kids, you know. So I would go and I would describe it. So from describer, scriber, you know, and I really do. At this point, I only know that my name is James Daly when I have to sign to something, but trust me, everything is a scriber. Yes.
All right, yes. So we're starting up here.
Yeah, we're going that direction.
Okay.
Oh, yes. Okay. Like that sound, that's the sound of a mangrove cuckoo.
Mangrove cuckoo.
Yeah, mangrove cuckoo. And on this trail as well, one of the things that I would like to show you is our national bird, which is the Montserrat Oriole. Mm-hmm. Icterus berry, it's only found on Montserrat.
Only.
And it's our only endemic species for Montserrat. I'll also try to show you a nest of that bird because it's very unique to us in that it's our national bird, and the red heliconia is our national flower. Mm. Now this bird actually builds its nest beneath the leaves of the heliconia.
So national bird has a relationship with the national flower.
Definitely.
National flower, okay.
And also feed its youngs from the flower of the heliconia, and also weave its nest from the heliconia, from the dry material of the heliconia. Mm. And it's really unique to Montserrat. Now this is the Oriole Walkway. This one starts from the coffee shop over at Fogarty, and then it ends here. The trail that we'll be doing would be the Duberry Cassava. See, it's actually linked into it.
Right.
Okay. So I'll just show you exactly how it happened. The many names that you call this tree. This is called the turpentine tree in the Caribbean. It's also called the naked Indian because of its color. But most of all, it's called the tourist tree. Because, you know, if you're in the tropics and don't put on your sunscreen lotion, this is exactly what would happen.
Yes.
Something I want to show you. Okay. Yeah. This tree. This is a tree that was into this species of tree was introduced from Malaysia way back in the days of cocoa plantation on Montserrat. Now cocoa was one of our trading crops, and that's the way the Caribbean used to, how the Caribbean used to flex, like I give you something, you give me something back. So cocoa was one of our trading crops. So this is a rubber tree that was introduced from Malaysia to plant with on the cocoa plantation sites.
When you say rubber band.
Rubber band, everything I'm okay. Talking about like that, you know. So what cocoa requires 50% shade for it to grow. Mm. You cannot just plant cocoa in the sun like that. It must have at least 50%. So just a little demonstration to show you. If I punch at this, it would give you a sap. You see what would happen there?
Wow.
That is exactly that what would happen. Now, if I want to collect like build a nice ball of like a rubber ball, mm-hmm. I can cut it in these scars, collect in both halves, and put it together, and I could get a nice ball where I can start bouncing.
Right away.
Right, yeah, like maybe a day or two after. Now, this is what you would call, that sap that is coming there, this is what you're going to get. Natural rubber. This is natural rubber.
You can see that.
Yeah? The forest is always important to us as for our livelihood. Yeah? That's natural rubber. So that's exactly what you're seeing there.
Rubber.
Yep.
So even doing enough, I get tired, so?
Yeah.
It's a question.
You could have definitely, because, you know, you can, because that's what tires being made
right,
from.
Right, so if I get enough,
definitely. So once you're in the forest and you start seeing these trees, what you can do is to just look around. There must be cocoa trees.
It's rubber band, no, yeah. Steam,
you know? Yeah. Yeah. Here we go. Here we go. You see, look at that. Look at that. I want it to come in the sunlight. You see? And look one right in front of my stick. Look at the edge of my stick. Yeah?
What is that?
That's a hoverfly. That's a fly. It's not a bee. It's a fly that hovers. Now, that's its job for the entire day. If it moves, it's actually flushing someone from its territory. And yeah? Okay, it moves and he's going to come right back. Just look at it. Look at it. Okay, you see it comes, okay, you see how it's actually flushing, okay. But it's going to come back.
Bite
it,
or anything?
No, it doesn't bite anything, it's just actually protecting its territory.
Oh, just check.
Yes, venom in the forest. My ears.
When am I venom?
Yeah, actually gets so sensitive.
Oh, when I am?
When I am in the forest.
Oh, I said venom.
No, I said when I'm in the forest.
Venom now?
No? No, not venom.
Yeah, that's an automatic turn back.
What happened? I heard a sound.
I heard it too.
And let me just check, double check.
Jesus Christ. Man.
Chiri. Look at me.
Look at what?
Look at me just.
What you see?
Yeah. You offend me, baby. That's not my gamble.
What you looking for?
No.
No, she's terrified of snakes.
No.
She's
terrified. No. No. This is called the black snake.
So we have a lot of this to meet up.
No. Not really. No. This, we have two species of snakes, which one is the coffin borer. And the coffin borer is a snake almost about the size of this. You know, with... It's looking mostly like a earthworm, but this one is the Montserrat racer, the black snake, and you can see how it's actually, you can see how it's tasting the air. You can see it, yeah. So this is a lovely snake, isn't it?
She's terrified of snakes.
Oh, she's terrified of snake?
Yep.
Oh, it causes no problem. Mm-hmm. This is a young male.
So,
yeah?
Poisonous, bite, anything?
No, it's harmless. This is, you know, when I'm having school programs, the kids would, if I was here this morning with a bunch of kids, they would take it up instead of me. You know, that's how it goes. You know?
I.
And then I'm going to put it down. You would see how fast it moves.
Put it back.
Okay. Okay. I'm gonna release it.
Oh.
No, 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 I'm just waiting for you guys.
No, when you suspicious walk, you know.
No. When you start slow down. Anything that I'm going to do, I'm going to tell you.
So you start slow down, you might say you hear something again.
This time it comes up.
Yeah, so what other, other than the snakes, what other wildlife animals are insects?
We have lots of different insects. And to be quite honest, scientists beginning to wonder why things that are seen on Montserrat are seen, because, you know, Montserrat is in the Lesser Antilles, and some of plant species and insects that should be seen only in the Greater Antilles are still seen on Montserrat. And why is it happening? We don't know. Okay. You know, we are in the center hills of Montserrat at the moment. Mm-hmm. The center hills of Montserrat is considered as like a place for PhD students when they're doing the internships and so. The center hills is very rich in diversity. You know, before volcanic eruptions, most of the concentration used to be in the South Sufre Hills. Mm-hmm. But seeing that we were pushed on this side of the island, we had to launch out more into these hills. I'm a forest ranger as well, mm-hmm. I should tell you as well. So, you know, I work with the department for over 30 years. And some of the things that you would find here, like, for instance, where we are, in this area, there's a species of lizard. We have 8 different species of lizards on the island. But in this particular area, which is special and unique to Montserrat, there's an animal, a lizard, which is actually like 16 inches in length. And it's nocturnal, it only comes out at night.
Oh, okay.
And when you're looking for it, at the edge of the back, you could see, you know, it's shown like a fluorescent. Mm-hmm. It's called the galley wasp. Diploglossus. That's the correct name for it. And it's like a half lizard and half snake. Now, you notice when I actually took up that snake and it was actually pushing out the tongue and all of that, sensing the ear to see what's around the surroundings. Now, this animal is a healthy animal. The galley wasp. But the same movements of the head of the snake, it would do that. The legs are almost helpless for an animal of that size, 16 inches in length. So whenever it's been attacked, it locks the legs to the body and wriggles more like a snake, you know, and moves very, very fast. But it's a lovely, healthy animal. Very little has been known about it because it's so hard to see. And we had projects where we actually came out and we did lots of different things, but we only managed to see maybe just like one. And these kind of, but we are seeing them in different sizes, so we know that they're here. And surprisingly, when I was going to school, it been noted that it only found in the woodlands area of Montserrat, which is this area that we're in. This is the habitat for it, and it's only seen in this area, never seen outside of this area. Yeah, so and you know, we have lots of different, you have the agoutis.
So the snakes, the agouti.
Mm-hmm.
What else we might meet up on? They say you're talking about the
snakes, agouti, lizard.
The gecko.
The dwarf gecko, there's a little dwarf gecko. And we also have a worm snake. And that's not the worm snake. I talked about the worm snake before. We also have a worm lizard, which is shiny lizard. And it's called Underwoody Montserrat tensi.
So we see an iguana up in this.
Iguanas would be in some of these trees. You know, you can't get away from these iguanas. Yeah, they're just all over Montserrat. This is a fruit.
A fruit?
Yeah,
pass this all the time.
Yeah, in Antigua. Mm-hmm. You have because it's found in the Lesser Antilles. And now you have people who are more fortunate than some. Mm-hmm. So here is it now. It's called sweet lime. It's a species of lime. Yeah?
Yeah, it's the lime.
The orioles are calling around there. You can hear that sound?
Yes, yes, yes.
That's the orioles. That's our national bird calling. I'll show you in a short while. Okay. Now, what would happen? That you could see right at the edge there, there's a little sap coming from it. Mm-hmm. Okay? Let me just show you something. My friend might be nice and easy. My friend probably has her nails done. And you see how nice her nails are looking.
Mm-hmm.
Now, probably I can't afford to really put on that clear. So what I would do, I'll get this, and I actually paste it onto my nails. Yeah.
But we passed this, and this is home.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah. Look at it. You see how clear it is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it would actually stay there for a long while. I work so much with these birds that sometimes I believe they know it's just an imitation of Scriber. Believe it, man. This is the sagebrush.
Yeah.
We you have it in Antigua?
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Yes. What do you use it for in Antigua? To feed animals and so?
Yeah, feed animals and so.
But we use them for washing our dishes?
And tea.
Yeah, okay, but we use it for making, you know, for scrubbing our pots and pans. You know, because if the texture of the leaves...
Rough
like a sandpaper.
Yes.
So it shines that instead of using Brillo...
Oh, yes.
And, you know...
So you use this?
Yes. So this is a species of sage.
Okay.
Yeah. This island is very much blessed with good water, you know.
Okay.
We only using about maybe 20% of water that this island generates.
This is cold.
Yeah, it's good, good, nice water, man.
Cold.
Yeah.
Refreshing too.
Definitely.
Oh, yes,
Lord. It's called a cat claw. You see what it's doing to this bird? These are some of the challenges that I actually encounter on my day-to-day, you know, around springtime.
Oh, it's a leaf. Okay.
Now this is a buzz that actually falls from a tree, and for ground dwellers, like birds that are on the floor. So when I get close, I always listen, because they can be trapped. This is an American kestrel. Yeah?
Yeah.
I have to be careful with this bird, because if it actually...
Oh, like
yeah,
a hawk.
Yeah, like, so I have to put it in the proper ringer's grip.
Is there a nest over it? Because...
It's a trap there,
you see. Wow.
So it's a natural trap?
Yeah, it's a natural trap. It actually traps bird.
Oh,
birds. You know? Oh my gosh. Sorry about it.
I still have to be
very careful with the talons.
Oh, you get okay and start getting ignorant.
No, if those talons actually touch me, it would cut me.
Oh.
You know, so I should really have a glove to really to deal with it.
But you can't pass it.
No, I can't pass it like this.
And you have to deal with this all the time?
You have to deal with this all the time. You know, around springtime every year, this occurs to some of our bird species, like the bridal quail dove. So this one actually probably came down to prey at something. Maybe a mice or something.
Oh,
yeah,
boy. Wow. Can't get any more real than this. You can't edit this. Wow. And he's like, he's still trying to grab you with a claw.
Yeah, you have to, you know something? Okay, you know something?
Walk with it?
I'm gonna walk with it.
The beaches are an integral part of Caribbean life, and in Montserrat, the Emerald Isle is no different. It was a pleasure for us to tour the island via speedboat. Meet our captain.
Your name?
My name is Hubert Buffon.
Hubert Buffon.
Yeah.
So how'd you end up with the name?
Well, my last name is Buffon, and my friends, when I was a young age, decided to shorten it from Buffon. To Buffy.
Yeah. Buffy the vampire.
No.
No relation.
Not related to the vampire.
Okay, alright. How long have you been out here in the waters, doing tours, exploring beautiful seas of Montserrat?
Well, I've been, you can say a long time, maybe about 20 years.
Wow.
But it's become more alive since over the last 10, 12 years where people started coming back to see Plymouth, wanting to see what happened in Plymouth and Kinsale and some of the other villages where they come from.
Mm.
Most of the islands populated people from that side, you know, basically like a 3-4 mile radius around the volcano.
Now, how can I tell you about the waters of Montserrat without having experienced it myself? Here's our snorkeling experience.
So, reef is just right over here.
So, what's the main attraction inside the reef? Like,
so a lot of times we get lucky, we do see turtles, mm-hmm. but it is nature, so you just never know. But it's
know what you're gonna see.
Yeah. This is a particularly healthy reef, though. This has lots of coral coverage, lots of sponges. Reef tops are just covered with life. This is a fish nursery, so this is where the young fish come to grow up.
And then the depth of it?
Right now we're only in about like 10, 15 feet in the top of the reefs where you can see where they're sort of yellows.
Yeah.
You know, that's only like 4 or 5 feet below.
Okay. So
and then we swim bottom. Back. A lot of the that's stuff that we're swimming over is like 10 feet deep.
Under the sea, under the sea. Darling, it's better down where it's wetter. Take it from me. Up on the shore, they work all day. Out in the sun, they slave away. While we've been boating full time to floating under the sea. Now you are the fish is happy as I flew the waves the world. The fish on the land ain't happy. It's hot Thursday and they're cold. But fish in the bowl is lucky. They in for a worse of fate. One day when the boss get hungry,
yes, you go beyond the pay.
But no, under the sea, under the sea. Nobody beat us, fry us, and eat us in fricassee. We want the land folks loves to cook. Under the sea, we after hook. We got no troubles, life is the bubbles under the sea.
After that amazing snorkeling experience, it was almost time to bid Montserrat farewell. But we couldn't leave the island without visiting the Easy Living Spa and Souvenir Shop. Take a look. Our departure back to Antigua, we chose to travel via air. It would only take us 20 minutes. But before we collect our boarding passes, here's a look at some great accommodations for your next visit to Montserrat.
In conclusion, Montserrat has so much to offer, from snorkeling to fine dining, history, exploration, lots of R&R. But don't let me tell you about it. Come and explore for yourself and make your next vacation a Montserrat vacation. Welcome to Montserrat, the Emerald Isle of the Caribbean.